heavens are opening over churches, glory to God. Churches that will consult with God. Churches that will talk to God. Churches that will decide that to do business with God. So what does an open heaven look like? There are at least four accounts in scripture where we saw open heavens take place. One was Ezekiel, and Ezekiel saw all kinds of stuff manifesting. He saw the throne of God. He saw the cherubim around God. He saw the wheel intersecting in the wheel. Ezekiel saw the Lord leave out of the most holy place in Jerusalem, walk through the holy place and go into the outer court. He saw God leave the temple in Jerusalem. He saw God stand on the Mount of Olives and call curses upon the city and the temple in Jerusalem. He saw the river of God coming forth from the throne of God. He saw trees on both sides. He saw this manifestation of the power of God, and he knew that the God that we serve is the God that is with us. And he's not the only one that saw open heaven visitations. There was a Stephen, as he was being stoned, he witnessed the open heaven. Then there's Jesus, as he was water baptized. The Bible says that the dove came, but the heavens opened over his head, and the voice came from heaven saying, "This is my beloved son in whom I am well pleased." But our first marker in scripture of an open heaven is in the 28th chapter of the book of Genesis. That is where Jacob had left from Beersheba on his way to Haran, leaving his father's house because he had deceived his father into blessing him, and also had taken the birthright from his brother. As he's leaving from there, the Bible says he comes to a place and he takes, please note the text, he took a stone from the place, a stone, and he laid his head on the stone. And during that night, the Bible tells us that the heavens opened over him and a ladder appeared from, and it touched the earth and went all the way up into the heavens. He noticed at the top of the ladder, there was God seated on the ladder. He also noted that angels were going up the ladder and down the ladder. The Lord began to share with him, "I am the God of your father, Abraham, the father, your God of your father, Isaac." He says, "I'm going to bless you, and through you shall all the nations of the earth be blessed." God says that "I'm going to extend your borders from the north, the south, the east, and the west. But you must in turn decide to serve me." The Bible tells us when Jacob arose from that place, he realized, "Oh, I'm in an awesome place." And he makes these two remarks, that this is none other than the house of God, and this is the gate of heaven. Glory. It is the house of God, and it is the gate of the heaven. Now, there are some pivotal things that we must examine in the text. There is a stone that was there, and he lays his head on the stone. The stone is indicative of the stone that the builders rejected. It is symbolic of the Lord, who is the rock of ages. He took his head and he laid his head on Christ. And as he laid his head on Christ, the head or the headship of man is the place where his emotions, his imagination, his creativity, his memory, the place for contemplation for man is the place of his headship. The reality is this, that when the Holy Spirit begins to move upon you and you say, "I feel God God in my heart. Glory. What God is actually doing, he is speaking to the mind of the man. For Proverbs tells us that the mind of man is the candle of the Lord. So when God formed Adam from the ground and breathed into Adam's nostrils, consider that he did not breathe into Adam's mouth. Glory to God. He breathed into the nostrils of the man. The nostrils are the place of your discernment. For 75% of your taste is in your nose. Glory. That is why when you are congested, it's difficult for you to taste your food. So when God breathed into nostrils, the Hebrew word for nostrils is also the mind. So when he breathed in the man, he breathed on the mind of man. So the man began to awake to a place of knowing and awareness. This was not a Neanderthal walking around scratching his knuckles on the floor, taking two stones together and finding fire, saying, ooh, ooh, ah, ah. That is not Adam at all. This is an intelligent man. For the Bible says God took all the animals to that man to see what he would name them. And whatever the man called it, that was its name. That same intellectual man sinned, and now he is exposed. And the Bible says he takes the leaves of the fig and he hides himself. Just hang on for a few more moments. You'll see where I'm going. He takes the figs and he hides himself. So when Jesus, let me jump ahead, when he sees Nathanael, he said to him, I saw you under the fig tree. Isn't that interesting? So Adam took the leaves of the fig to hide himself, but he said to Nathanael, I saw you under the fig tree. Let me deal with this. Remember when Jesus was coming into Jerusalem and he was hungry that day, and he noticed that there were some figs, or he saw a fig tree whose leaves were there. Now a fig tree has or blossoms two times in the year. It casts the fruit first, then the leaf, and then another fruit. So when Jesus is passing by, he notices that the leaves were on the tree, but there was no fruit to indicate I am fruitful, but there was no product of its fruitfulness. So Jesus has to curse the tree, and when they came back the next day, it was withered up from the roots. So then why, Jesus, do you curse the tree? Just give it a few more days to produce its fruit. It is because when the man sinned in the garden, the tree helped him out to hide his sin. Glory. So God has to condemn the tree because the tree had joined in with the sin of the man. But he also has to allow the tree to be a part of an awareness of the man to be able to see the heaven opening over his head. Glory. Because everything that God does is good. Let me go then back to Jacob. As he's laying there, he sees this ladder. The ladder is a place or where the angels are going up and down. The indication is that angels are going up to share with God the activities of the earth, and coming down from God to share from God to the earth the activities or the answers from God for the earth. So then the ladder represents doing business with God. Hallelujah. Doing business with God in the heavenly. So now here is Jacob, who is laying on this rock, who's laying on Christ, and now his mind becomes captivated by God, so much so that when he gets up, then he names the place Bethel, saying this is the house of God, only to come back years later and say, this is El Bethel, the God of the house of God. What are you saying, preacher? When he awoken from his sleep, he noticed that this is the house of God. Here is where God dwells. But I also understand that it is the gateway into heaven. This is the portal where the exchange takes place. Why is the gate so important? It's at the gate that business is done in the earth. When the kings would place an announcement, it would be at the gate. Glory to God. If you were going to go into contract over real estate, you had to come to the gate. If you wanted to be released from an oath, you had to come to the gate. If it was time for war to take place, the king would send the message. So it would now go to the gate, so everyone who would come in and out would know that it's time for war. If you were a merchant and you wanted to bring your merchandise to sell in the marketplace, well, you had to go to the gate because the market was at the gate. If you were coming in from selling at another town or another city, you had to stop at the gate to pay the taxes because it's at the gate that business is done. So we have Jacob saying the house of God is also the gate of heaven. What he is saying, preacher, that he notices that wherever God would set his house, that's where he decides to do business in the earth. So when he set up the tabernacle, it was his house by which he would do business. When he gave them the temple, it was his house by which he would do business. And when he established the church in the earth, it was his house by which he would do business. And when he filled you with the Holy Ghost, you became his house by which God would do business. So preacher, what happened in the business of God? God will start to download dreams and ideas and visions and revelations. Are you hearing me? And prophecies and promises unto you. In his house, he sits down and begins to share. Here is what I want you to do in this area. Here is what you are to say to your family. Here is what you are to do with your friends. Here is what you are to carry to that area. It is the place where God begins to empower you and begin to show. Here is my idea for your life. Set up this business and now do it that way. Take the plan here and talk to that person there, and all of a sudden your business is blossoming. It's not because of your ingenuity. You just decided to take your plan to the house of God. And when you took it to the house of God, God said, I can do business with somebody I can trust. Hear what I'm trying to say to you. It is no surprise that God would bless our sister and cause her to come out of debt. Why? Because she chose to do business with God. And when you do business with God, when God sees I can trust you, God then decides, let me load you up with some more because I can trust you with a little. Preachers, you gotta understand, if you want God to use you, you gotta let him see he can trust you with a revelation, and know that the revelation has not come from you. It's come from God. And know that the power that you have when you're preaching is not you, it's God. It's just his grace on your life. And God sees, I can trust you when you get up to share my word. I can trust you when you begin to pray for people. I can trust you when you're doing ministry. So then God says, if I can trust you with that little bit of anointing, let me pour out some more on your life. If I can trust you with that bit of revelation, let me give you some more. You gotta know, it's not you at all. It's just the heavens that are opening over your head. God will start to download dreams, ideas, songs. He'll give them to you and he'll begin to show you, if you're working like this, I'll expand your territory. Entrepreneur, I need you to know, if you'll take your plan and lay it out before God, you'll watch God tell you what else to add to your plan and what else to take away. He'll show you what product or service that you need to do, and before long you had handled hundreds, he'll move you into thousands. He'll take you from thousands and move you into millions. He'll take you from millions and move you into billions. I need you to know, glory to God, that in this room right now, the next big idea that will change America is already in this room. We don't have to go and look for some intelligent person. We just need individuals that decide, here I am, God. Whatever you want to teach me, whatever you want to show me, he'll show you how to make a car. He'll show you how to make a phone. He'll show you how to start a bank. He'll show you how to run the restaurant. He will show you the next idea that will save the homeless. He'll give you the plan that will reboot the government permanently. He will show you the idea to help with health care. He'll give you the plan to cure the cancer. Are you hearing me? It's already on the inside of you, and the devil is afraid that one day you might wake up and realize, I know who I am. I know who I serve. The devil is scared that when you start worshiping, God starts downloading ideas. He's afraid that when you start praising God, that God will infuse you with authority and power. So he wants to make sure that you constantly stay distracted. But I got news for the devil today. God is opening the heaven over the chosen vessel, and right now, glory to God, the plan that you want to work is in the atmosphere. The heavens are opening over your head. The anointing is falling on your life, on your ministry, on your house. God is touching your finances. God is healing your body right now. The heavens are opening. The heavens are opening. The heavens are opening. Yes, Lord. Receive it now. 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 He's changing your house. He's changing your life. He's touching your son. He's touching your daughter. Receive it now. Receive it now. He's healing your body. He's making a way. He's blessing your business. He's anointing your head with fresh oil. Receive it now. Receive it now. It's open. is open. Do business right now. Praise him. Worshiping him. Make your petition known to God. The heavens are open over this place. Yes, Lord. You will see greater things than these. You will see greater. You will see greater. This is not the end. Come on, Jesus. This is not the end. You will see greater. Last time I was here, I saw the balcony filled with people. So when I walked out today, I looked up because I wanted to see, is it still there, Lord? Is it still there, Lord? God says to tell the chosen vessel. The Lord says to tell you, Bishop Young, this is not the end. You shall see greater. You may not see it right now, but what I see is in that balcony, there are people of all ethnicities whose hands are raised right now. Glory. They're worshiping along with us. God is feeling this place. You shall see greater. It is no coincidence that the housing is being built next to here. Glory. It is just a sign from God. He's bringing houses to fill his house. Did you catch that? God is bringing houses to fill his house. Now, for those who understand the challenge that internet and online TV services does to this, it puts God, hallelujah, in a difficult predicament. Because it seems like people are choosing online churches over being in the actual physical house. But the drawing card will be this. That the manifestation that you're going to experience over these next 6 months in this church is going to be so extraordinary that someone who's at home watching this service right now will say, oh, I got to get there because what I feel here is great, but I can see something more powerful is going on. I got to get there. You don't know it right now, but somebody who's watching this service is on the floor crying out to God. Because the power of God just hit them. They'll be coming. You'll see them. You'll see them in these seats. They'll be coming. You should raise your hands to God. We're going to pray. As those hands are raised, Jesus tells Nathanael that what you're going to see, you're going to see the Son of Man. And they, when you see heaven open, the angels will be ascending and descending on the Son of Man, which was this. What Jacob saw when he put his head on the rock, he saw that ladder, but he didn't understand that the ladder was in fact Jesus. So what he did, hallelujah, he took his head, which was on the rock, it was actually at the feet of Jesus. Because Jesus was indeed, he was the ladder. Which means right now, glory, if you have Jesus, you have the means and the access to do business with the heavens. Right now. Right now. Not to scare any of you, not to weird you out or anything like that. But we're about to start to pray. And some of you have sons and daughters that you've been praying for a long time. Some of you right now aren't even sure where they are or what they're doing. God's about to dispatch angels as we pray. Hear what I'm telling you? God is about to dispatch angels right now to exactly where they are. Now, let me tell you how I know it's real. Had a preacher friend of ours. He had gotten himself in some stuff and decided he was going to run away, just go. His family came saying, you know, I don't know where he is, I don't know what's going on. In tears, broke down crying. Because God, in that moment, showed me exactly where he was. Amen. Hear me. Amen. At 12 midnight, we all got in the car and start driving to a location that God had shown me in the spirit. Oh, yes. Drove 3 hours, got to this hotel, saw the man's car outside the hotel. I'm telling you, I know God is real. So I asked the front desk, can you ring such and such room? They said, we have no guests by that. I said, I know he's here because his car is out there. They said, no one that by that name is here. Told the family, wait a second, we're going to pray. The Lord, while we were praying, God said, he's under this name. Went to the front desk. I said, do you have somebody by this name in your hotel? They said, yes, we sure do. I said, call that room right now. Call the room, because he wasn't answering the cell phone. Call the room. Hey, man. Same God. Went to that room, start praying and ministering with the man. Now he's back in ministry. I'm telling you what I know about my God. I don't care if you can't find them. God knows where they are. And we're about to pray. Yande kitamo kushana. And God's about to dispatch angels to your son, to your daughter. And their mind might be messed up right now. Glory. But as God sends angels in that room, Mande Sataramaya, he's going to reveal to them who he is. So don't be surprised if they say to you, something weird happened to me. This light came in the room. Glory to God. As those hands are raised, hearts are open. Mom, dad, that's your son. That's your daughter. Pop, my mom, that's your granddaughter. That's your grandson. That devil thinks he's crazy. Messing with your family. Messing with your son, your daughter, your grandson, your granddaughter. But he doesn't understand. We do business with heaven. We have a promise from God. Our whole family shall be saved. Father, our hands are stretched to you right now. Jesus, we don't rest well, Lord, because our son, our daughter's out there. Our hearts are aching, Father. Lord, we heard our bishop say to us, pray for our children to be saved. Father, we heard today, Lord, that a 14-year-old died and a 4-year-old died. God, we can't just take that lightly. That's somebody's daughter. That's somebody's son, Jesus. Oh, my. Father, yande shoko tamasha. Jesus, somebody's son in this room is on drugs, out of their mind right now. Somebody's daughter, God, is on drugs, out of their mind right now. Someone, God, right now, their son, their daughter, the granddaughter, the grandson. The adversary is messing with their heart, messing with their mind, stripping away their identity. I know you, Jesus. I know you. I may not know where they are, but I know you. Send angels right now. Send angels right now to protect them and cover them. Mande kuramasa. Send angels right now, Kandekite, to protect their step, God. Send angels, God, right now to spare their life. And Father, I pray this. Let your arms of love begin to wrap around them, squeeze them ever so tightly. May they know that you're real and that you're God and that you love them. Father, I'm praying right now for that person who's watching this service online. I pray in the name of Jesus that the Holy Spirit will invade the living room, will invade the hotel. God, will invade the car right now. That the Holy Spirit will begin to overtake them in Jesus' name. And Father, I thank you. We will testify that you have done it, Lord. That you have saved. That you have delivered. That you have made ways. We know it is you, God, and we trust you, and we believe you right now in Jesus' name. Amen. Will you clap those hands, give Jesus praise today? Glory. If you're here and you don't know Jesus, you've never given your life to him, you've never surrendered to him, you've never received the waters of baptism, you've never received the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, I need you to know that God loves you with a love everlasting. He's always loved you, and he cares for you. There are altar workers, ministers that are here who are glad that these are your friends. They will gladly receive you today. They've been waiting on you. They can't wait to pray with you. They can't wait to join hands with you. They can't wait to hear the request that you might have. Whatever it may be, will you come? We want to pray with you. We want to pray for you. There is no situation, there's no problem that's too difficult that our God cannot solve. So if you've never received water baptism, will you come? We want to pray with you. If you want to receive the infilling of the Holy Spirit, will you come? We want to pray with you. If you want to be restored to God, it's been a while since you have walked with him. Will you come? We want to pray with you. If you need healing in your body, will you come? We want to pray with you. We want to pray for you. God loves you. If you're struggling in your family and in your life, with your children, with your relationships, we want to join our hands in agreement in prayer with you. Our God can do it. There's nothing too difficult for God. There's nothing too strenuous for our God. There is nothing he cannot solve. Try him out. See what he can do. See how he can change it. See how he can make it better. He's more than able. He's more than able. He's more than able. Glory to God. Glory to God.
Jesus, just now.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. Come to Jesus. Come to Jesus. Just now.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. He's able.
He is able.
Only trust him.
Oh, only trust.
Only trust.
Only trust.